Well, this was important because we're trying to get everybody from the state on. We've had Carrie. Carrie,
what did you talk about? Probably Michael Jackson.
No, PJ Harvey.
Okay, fair enough.
Well, this is the thing, was we had no, I had no idea that she was like in a rock band prior to, you know, while she was still doing comedy.
An amazing band. Incredible.
Oh yeah.
Band. Yeah.
But she was great. So we're going to eventually, by the time we have, I guess we have another 350 records to do. So
yeah.
I have a feeling we can get pretty much everybody by the time this is over.
I think Mark Maron pulled it off. Eventually he got every single one, all 11 of us.
Oh, really? Well, yeah, but that's Maron, though, dude.
I mean, I know.
I am
oranges. Myers and Maron. I never mix them in my brain.
I am kind of afraid of Mark Maron, by the way, too. We're both regulars at the store, and it's like I've jammed with him. He's done the goddamn Comedy Jam, which is his music comedy show that I have, and he's shredded on guitar, and we've had just great moments on stage, but off stage, I am so afraid of him.
I think he cultivates that fear. I had that same relationship with him. He did our live show, Stella, in New York for years, and it was always like, oh, am I saying the right thing?
it's like, okay, let me just, did I step on that? Did I say everything right? Like, I get so, like, self-conscious when I'm talking to him and to Joe Rogan, but Joe Rogan scares me just because Joe Rogan is just one giant lat muscle. So from that. The police. This is our third record on this list. So we've done Synchronicity. What was the other one we did?
Outlandish D'Amour,
and now this one.
Reggatta de Blanc.
But I've always been somebody that kind of was like in and out with this band. I know all the hits, so it's been really fun for me to just like really dive into these records. But we asked to try to get you on a while ago, and then when this came out, you specifically said The Police. So tell me your journey with the band The Police.
I mean, you know, I'm 51 years old, so the height of The Police was the height of my preteen kind of really getting into rock music and getting into music and also starting to play in bands as a young preteen wannabe drummer. And so I really just was like, what is this? I fell in love with The Police. One memory I have was being at summer camp when I was about 12 and seeing a piece of graffiti on the bunk wall that said, "The Police don't rule anything. They're only so-so." And somehow I was like, I need to know more about this band. but I went to go see them, I think, in 83 at the Ghost in the Machine tour at the Richfield Coliseum in Cleveland, Ohio. And they the Go-Go's opened for The Police. So it was quite a memorable show. Yeah. Less so for my father, who took us because he slept through the entire thing.
My dad took me to see Poison, and I don't think I've ever seen my dad more annoyed in his life.
Exactly. my first concert I saw was the Rolling Stones in 81 at the same Coliseum, which was pretty amazing even at the time. But anyway, I saw them again when they toured more recently, you know, in 2007 or whatever that was. And that was less exciting in a way. I felt like they were a little more boring.
Really?
But I've always loved The Police. I deep dive on them every few years. I go back and I re-listen just because I just really do marvel at what they pulled off. But I do feel like they have, some of their, I don't think they're consistent necessarily. Like some of their songs, even on this record, especially on this record, I would say feel like filler to me.
Yes, and, totally.
And I think this one in particular, I think you could tell that they were just like, let's whatever, put this on, who cares, you know, just fill out the running time.
Yeah.
But the hits are just so undeniable. And Message in the Bottle specifically is like one of the absolute great masterpieces of songwriting and production and lyrics and everything. It's certainly one of my all-time favorite songs. And as a drummer my whole life, you know, studying that song and, you know, all the trying to figure out how do they do that and what's the overdubs with the hi-hats, and, you know, it's just such an amazing, intricate, imaginative, beautiful drum line along with everything else.
So maybe because I'm 41, so I'm 10 years younger than you. And
good for you. Like, that's great.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's my parents. You know, they waited. I mean, but what I'm curious is, it's like, I don't think I can, because you said something in there, which is like about that, like they pulled off something incredible. It's like, I don't think I can capture how big the Police were. How big were the Police, you know, at the height of their fame? Because to me, it's just like Every Breath You Take and Message in a Bottle, Walking on the Moon, everything off the greatest hits. But like, I never could conceive of like actually, like, were they at one point the biggest band in the world?
I mean, I think they were. I mean, I wasn't when they were at their height. I was a kid, so I wasn't, like, you know, a journalist or anything, nor am I now. But I definitely can tell you, among my friends in Shaker Heights, Ohio, they were massive. And we had the T-shirts and the posters, and it was a pretty big deal for all of us. And collecting the records and looking at the covers and watching the videos on MTV. And it was... definitely. And I would say that among all the people I've met in my age group over the course of my life, quite a few of them would say the Police is their favorite band.
So what's so cool about them then? Because to me, it's just like, it's like punk ska. And I know that's like dumbing it down a little bit. So I don't mean to, like, I can see Morty's like getting pissed off right now. But no, but it's like, I get the hits. But like you said, there, a lot of this record seems to be a little bit of filler.
It is. I think it is. But it does, you know, I think there's different kinds of records. And, you know, as a kid, I think that when I had this record, I probably played Message in a Bottle and Bring on the Night and Walking on the Moon a lot more than the other ones. And that's fine. You know, I think if you can make Message in the Bottle, you're good.
Yeah.
You don't need to worry about, you know, it's I think there's just different kinds of records. Some bands make records that are really a full piece, and that even the lesser songs fit into a grand scheme that makes you want to listen to the whole thing over and over. I don't think the Police were ever that way particularly. They seem to be more song based to me.
Sure.
Yeah.
You know, to go with what you're saying, it's, I think there is something, you know, really cool about this band. Like you said, the songs that rule really rule. And then the other ones, you know, I've skipped over a little bit. But that's not saying they're not good songs. It's just like when you have something like Message in a Bottle.
Yeah.
Then it just shows you how, like you said, it's filler compared to that.
The truth is, though, like... You can just listen to what Stuart Copeland, the drummer, is doing alone on any of these songs, and you can get so much out of it. You know, he never relaxes, and there's always something different or interesting. And the more you try to break, you don't have to be a drummer, just the more you try to break down what he's doing exactly and how he changes it up and where he puts the fills and where, you know, the way he, and this way that they would take these reggae ideas and put them into a punk rhythm or a punk feeling song otherwise. It's just to me, that is kind of endlessly interesting, while at the same time, you know, there are songs that are clearly not thought through as much.
sure completely. This is a great record. I do think I enjoy Outlandis a little bit more. I love how raw Outlandis is.
Yeah. And Outlandis is more of a one that I think you could listen to the whole thing over and over, you know?
Yes. There's not much filler on that. But this is a great record. So, all right, so let's find out the history about it. Morty, do you want to fill us in?
There you go. Released on October 2nd of 1979 on A&M Records and produced by the band with Nigel Gray, this is the second album by the British-American post-punk, new wave, rock, jazz, and reggae-influenced power trio. And for anyone who doesn't know, the Police are Stuart Copeland on drums, percussion, and vocals, Andy Summers on guitar and vocals, and Sting on bass and lead vocals. And Josh already said, you'll remember we did Synchronicity, which is their last album, and we did Outlandis to Amour, which is their first album. So let me just catch you up where the fellows were going into this one. Only 3 months after that debut was released, the band was already working on the follow-up. They'd had a couple of modest hits with Roxanne and Can't Stand Losing You and a tour of America. And they'd really found their sound and tightened as a band through that. So like their debut, they convinced their record company to let them again go into the small studio Surrey Sound with Nigel Gray engineering and co-producing to keep the costs down and to give them complete artistic control, but also to stick with the formula of a successful first record.
Yeah.
In fact, they paid for this record themselves with the profits from their first album. So they were really thinking ahead, so they were staying ahead of the record company jive, which is really interesting for them. As the debut took about 6 months to piece together, they felt confident enough to only book about 5 weeks to record this one. The band was ready, but almost all of the songs were new, so they were brought in by whoever wrote them, worked on, and recorded quickly. Sting had really come into his own as a songwriter, and 4 of his 5 solo compositions on here were the singles. He wasn't as prolific up until this point, though, so Stewart also wrote 3, and 2 are credited to the whole band. It'd be the last time Sting would come up short in that department. Although they had a few interruptions to go play some gigs and tours, they ended up recording it all in about 3 non-consecutive weeks and canceled the last 2 weeks. And like their first album, their manager, Stewart's brother, Miles Copeland, came up with this title as a tongue-in-cheek mock French translation, this time for white reggae, the music they integrated into their sound.
Although, which everybody knows, yeah. I hate white reggae.
Right.
This is 311.
Yeah.
If 311 like got caught in the Andes Mountains and had to eat themselves, I would be so happy. I'm sorry. Right. Did anybody see the movie Alive?
But the police is really, yes, white reggae, but it's just the police. It's just, yes. Right. It's their thing.
I won't even put the police in the white reggae of Slightly Stupid or Sublime or anything like that. Like they're more of a punk.
I hate
they're more
of a punk things too. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank. Oh, see, I knew you liked. By the way, thank you for putting that picture of me behind you. That is.
I keep this here. I've kept this here probably for the past 25 years. I keep it here as just an inspiration to, you know, I remember when I was in preschool. I knew that I wanted to have a podcast someday, counting down albums, and I knew that this would be the thing to look at every day and say, this is going to be what I'm going to do.
Oh, you know what's funny? If we go into my other room, I have a shrine to you as well. So,
oh, good.
And because I'm a huge, huge fan of the state and role models and everything, and I knew that if I have a picture of you up on my wall, it would push me to break through into the industry and work with incredible comics and one day do a podcast with you.
You see, so it all comes around.
Oh my God, so full circle. Sting would call it synchronicity.
Great callback.
Thank you very much. Morty, finish. What do you got? Yeah.
I keep scrolls of both of you in my mezuzah, just in case anyone was wondering. Although they only put out 5 studio albums in their entire career, one more sec. It became the first of their remaining 4 albums that all went to number 1, starting with this album. Yeah, every one of them.
Number 1 is incredible. It's one of the best rankings you can get.
Yeah, that's what I've heard. I'll have to take your word for it. And allowed them to go on their first world tour that included concerts in unlikely places like Egypt, Greece, India, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Mexico. Almost all of them filmed, if you watch the video.
Although those places are not as unlikely to those people who live in those places.
Yeah, if they live there,
they just don't get
them
saying they're unlikely destinations
for
concerts.
But like if you live in Taiwan, you're not like, it's so weird to be in Taiwan. That, like, you,
I think they're constantly shocked. That's why they're they're just.
Like, why? Why am I in this foreign country?
I born here?
How do
why
I speak
am
this
I used
language?
To all of these customs?
This is not my beautiful junk. So although they only put out 5 studio albums in their entire career, they remain one of the most successful, popular, and influential bands and have sold over 75 million records.
Good for them.
Good God.
But how many NFTs have they sold?
Not many. Not That's many. Because they quit beforehand.
How much ether do they have in their wallet?
You know, Sting's huge into Dogecoin. Just to let you know. And Ethereal, I don't even know. I got to, you know, I just put all my money in lithium. Come on, lithium. All right, let's dive into this record because it really is fantastic. And there's a bunch of songs in here I want to get to. You were even going to talk about Da Filler. The album opens with Message in a Bottle, which, David, you just said is one of the greatest songs possibly ever.
I would put it in one of the, I would say for me, I'd put it in my top 10 if I ever made one, which I may, but I wouldn't say it to you on this podcast because I'd wait to release it as a TikTok.
Okay. Yeah, I could see that. Minute. But like do like five segments, each a minute long.
Yeah.
So the lonely castaway that finds some comfort in the world's similar feelings is the perfect imagery to start a record that very much deals with isolation and alienation. It follows into a metaphor that aims to explain the pitfalls of being heartbroken and alone. At the end, the protagonist learns that he's not the only lonely person. With a driving rhythm and a guitar riff that sounds sort of like Blue Oyster Cult's Don't Fear the Reaper, this expertly reintroduced the band and remains perhaps their most perfect song. This really is extremely special, especially the outro. JT, play it. Send it. All right, kill it. All right, so this song is actually really special to me because, so David, I created this show called The Goddamn Comedy Jam where comics do stand up, then they tell a story about a cover song.
Yep.
And what it means to them, and then they sing it. And the first show.
How come I've never been invited to this?
No. I actually, what I was going to do at the end was say, hey, I would love for you to come and play drums when we get to do this again at the Roxy, because just watching your arm work right there, I can tell you're top notch.
I can play the drums.
Yeah. Well, you know, you should have you do a drum battle off with Bill Burr.
Steve Agee and Brendan Small, two other comedians, did this show Baked for years.
Yeah.
Where they would have comedians come on and play songs, and I would play the drums and sing songs, and it was a total blast.
It's the best. It's the best. But at the first show, because you can imagine how nervous you are doing like the first show. Anytime you do a show in Los Angeles, it's scary. Are people going to come? And I did have Bill Burr on it, but it opened with Matt Bronger doing Skulls by the Misfits, and the crowd was sitting, and I could tell they were interested, and it was you know, well received to a point. Then Jay Larson, another comic, went up, and he did Message in a Bottle, and he fucked it up so bad. He was singing the verse during the chorus, and the band had to, he was so off like rhythm and key that the band had to follow him. And you look at it, the audience, and everybody was like laughing and getting really into it. And then that was the moment. That was the moment where I was just sat back. I was like, yeah, this is going to be huge.
Wow.
And it was great. So this song, just besides it being incredible, it's just, you know, it's my whole world changed when Jay Larson did this live.
So I thought when you said fucked it up, that was your way of saying like he did great. Like,
oh man, he fucked it up. Put some stank on it. He did. He fucked, but listen, it was garbage. But he, man, it was just such a beautiful moment. You know, thoughts on this song of why you love it so much? Or,
well, I mean, it's the one song. It's one of the songs that I've studied in different ways over the years, and like just take it apart. Like it's all, the guitar line is a lot more complicated than it seems. Like it seems like you're just like playing these arpeggiated four chords, but they're set up in a weird way. And I remember it was one of the first songs I heard when I was learning to play the drums, and I was like, wait a minute, what's going on here? You know, there's just so much intricacy, and like, and then just being blown away. And then I actually didn't really listen to the lyrics, which is common for me, until much later in life. And then I was like, oh, there's a whole story here that's amazing as well.
Yeah.
And I remember they opened with this song on their 2007 tour that I went to, and that was pretty damn exciting to just be sitting in the stadium with many, many thousands of people, and then this sort of envelops the crowd as the start. It was pretty insane. I also, one of the things that I do to waste time online is I make these little videos called What If They Sucked, where I like to take a song and just sort of alter it just enough to make it sound like the band really sucks. And so in honor of today, I did that with Message in the Bottle. If you want to hear.
Yes, I would love that. I would love to hear it. Jer?
Here it is. You got to keep listening.
Ha, 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 ha.
I mean, that's it. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Dude, I did a spit take. That was so fucking funny.
Well, like messages in a butthole.
Oh man, can you please do that with Bring On the Night too? Well, please tell me you've got one.
I did do it with Everything She Does Is Magic. You can see all of this at davidwain.com.
Oh, everybody go to davidwain.com. Morty, you got anything else to add to this?
Absolutely. So the riff had been written on the road in 1978 under a different melody, but it was modified and the lyrics were written during these recording sessions, and it became their first UK number one, where it stayed for 4 weeks prior to the album coming out. Although in the US, it only went to number 74.
And also, I mean, let's be honest, who cares about the UK?
Yeah.
Sure. So yeah. 74, America.
Yeah.
I just can't imagine that this wasn't higher in the U.S. That's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. All right. Reggatta de Blanc. So this band composed this title jam with Sting's vocalizations. It was an example of what they were like live at the time. This actually might be my favorite moment on the entire record. JT, play it.
Yeah.
This slaps, dude. All right, you know what? This is labeled as an instrumental. I was looking at different lyrical sites, labeled as an instrumental, but he's constantly saying yayo, which yeah. I don't know if you guys know this, is a way a lot of people call cocaine yayo. So maybe that's what this is about, considering by the drive.
They're so pure, though, those guys. In my mind. You know. In my preteen
maybe
mind.
Maybe it's tantric cocaine.
To me, though, like the three blonde-haired, like young guys, like playing around in the studio, like, and there's videos, and like just the camaraderie, and that just the pure soul of the Police is this song, like the way that they're just singing together, and just like, it does feel like it's a party, or like you're at a music festival, and everyone's just like having a cheer. I love this song. I love it.
I love it too. Let me ask you both this question, considering you know you both kind of like really were there. During a lot of this, like if one of the band members, and not Sting, but if Stewart or Andy weren't a part of this band, would they be as big as they became? I mean, each one of them seems to fit like a certain like is they're all equally important. Am I right or wrong?
In my mind, I think you're basically right. And I do think Andy Summers is often overlooked for how innovative and interesting what he did was. However, as great as his contribution was, it doesn't really compare to Sting or Stuart Copeland. Stuart Copeland is, you know, considered by many to be the greatest rock drummer of all time, or one of the top three at least. And
yeah.
Sting is Sting. I mean, you know, so it's hard to their contributions to the band and to music are transcendent of even the Police. It's just, you know, unquantifiable, I think. Andy Summers was a really great, interesting, new, innovative guitar player in many ways. Like any great trio, they are the trio that you can't really separate it. Yeah.
Sure.
I do a quick barrel roll. I'd say just because you asked. Sting, you know, as we already talked about before, Sting was going to make it happen for himself. He even said to the band, basically, and he had said to every journalist that asked him, he was like, I'm using this as my way to get where I need to get, you know, and at some point I might, you know, lose the band over that. Sting always knew it.
Yeah.
I don't think it would have happened for Sting without the Police, because I think remember, Andy was 10 years older. So he had like a serious career and learned and knew a lot. What he brought to the table was a lot of musicianship that a lot of other guys that would have come up about that time with punk rock, whatever, wouldn't have known as much. So they were very fortunate with that. But other than that, I just have to say, I admire you for having come up in garage bands where the bands that we had to play, because I'm the same age as you, were like Neil Peart, and Stuart Copeland.
Right.
It was like singers and drummers in the 80s who tried to be in garage bands. My testicles almost fell off as a singer of what they asked me to sing, and the drummers were killing themselves.
Luckily, I had no problem butchering all of it and just to get through it.
All right. Well, I wanted to ask you this, David. So like the title's translation, what is something people get wrong about you?
What is something people get wrong about me? I would say that sometimes people will say something like, people sometimes come up to me and they say, oh, I saw you in that movie, Role Models. You played the guitar in that one scene in the camping trip. That's so cool. How did you get involved in that? And how did you get that part? And I was like, well, I cast myself because I was the writer and director of it. And they're like, oh, that's weird. I don't know. I think a lot of people think of me as mainly like a sex symbol, or just they think of me as like, oh, just he's a set of abs, you know, with nothing else upstairs. But I think people should know that I have a brain, and I have thoughts, and I have feelings and dreams.
Yeah. God, just perfect. Just perfect. Yeah. Morty, is there anything you want to add to this?
Absolutely. So this originally started as a live extended jam that was in the middle of Can't Stand Losing You from the first album. They would have to extend their sets because all the songs they knew took like 9 minutes. Because at the time people were playing punk, and if Stuart was really on, they would go even quicker on stage. So they basically extended this entire middle section. And then for this album, because once again, they were a little lacking in material, they just went, fuck it. Let's just put that jam that we always do.
So glad they did.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Two things that come to mind about their tour. One was that I couldn't believe, considering how intricate the drum lines are, that Stuart Copeland plays them faster live. Like that's just insane to me. And the second thing was, I don't know if this is true. You probably know. I remember hearing that, you know, they really were in many ways an equal trio through their album making time. And then when they had the reunion tour, it was entirely like, okay, this is Sting's operation. Do whatever he says. And that's that, or we're not going to do it. And the other two were like, yep, sure, whatever.
I think Sting definitely, I mean, listen, he's the most successful. He really didn't need to do the Police tour. I'm glad I went to that too. I'm glad he did it because it was a culmination.
You're saying as a solo artist, you think Sting is the most successful of the three?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, yeah. I mean,
you ever heard that
Yele
song, David? I mean, come on, dude. Desert Rose, yele.
I think it's very it's very debatable who of the three has been the most successful. But
that is true. That is true. All the girls I know love Stuart.
Yeah.
Yeah. So although this wasn't a single, here's the funny thing about it. This is like a throwaway thing. This won them their first Grammy. This was for Best Rock Instrumental Performance. Even as a single. So that shows you like sort of like how they're cast off, how they're just an afterthought of what they put on stage to fill time.
They're just castaways.
All right. Maybe I think this next one, track three, might I kind of consider it a little bit of filler. It's All Right for You. It's not a bad song. Morty picked this out, and I do agree with this. Lyrically, this reminds us of a song. Go ahead and play it, JT. All right, kill it. This is almost like a new wave Bob Dylan Subterranean Homesick Blues, you know? Just lyrically, it's like, ski bottom dee sam doo lam pee tan doo bot ski. Also, what's that other song where it's like, it's all right, my. I'm singing Wild Wild West, too.
Yeah.
Wow, did I just realize Wild Same Wild thing. West just bit off of Subterranean Homesick Blues?
Also, I've always wondered, what does he mean? Limp wrist, tight fist, contact, no twist, black dress, no mess. You know, it's obviously gobbledygook, but I like it.
Very gobbledygook. But I wanted to ask you this. I wanted to ask you this, though. When did you first feel like you would do all right in the business?
Well, it really depends on what you mean by all right. I knew that, I had a lot of luck very early on, right out of college, because our my sketch comedy troupe from college got a TV show on MTV. And that was insane. And we knew at the time how lucky and special that experience was. And so in my early 20s, I remember saying to Ken Marino very vividly, like, if this is all we ever do, it's been still quite an amazing ride, you know. And but I never felt, and still don't feel, like, secure in the future. It's just not really the nature of what we do so much. And I certainly had a lot of struggles in my late 20s through my early 30s in terms of wondering if I can do this and wondering if I can support myself. And I guess maybe somewhere in my mid-30s, I had enough work in a row that happened that I felt like, okay, I'm secure enough to know that I could probably keep doing this in some form throughout my productive years. So I guess, you know, around the time that we did that Stella show on Comedy Central, and then I, after that, made this movie, The 10, and I just, like, started working more consistently, did my first studio movie right after that. And, but I've been busy and consistently working in a certain way since then, but not necessarily always making money or a lot of money. And, you know, it's always a question of what's next.
So, but when you were doing the state, because I remember talking to Carrie about it and her saying that, like, I think it was for the second season, you guys, for your promo ad, you used all of the negative reviews.
Yeah.
So, I mean, was there a moment while you were doing the state, you're like, yeah, this might be it?
Oh, because... for sure. All the moments. I mean, it was never clear. Although I think what fueled us and got us through that was the 11 of us were such close friends and such big sort of cheerleaders of each other that, and we had as a group, we had such a cocksure attitude about who we were and a very inflated attitude that served us a lot. And we just thought we were the best thing that's ever happened and the funniest people on earth. And when an MTV executive or anyone tried to question that, we were just like, fuck you, you know? And so it kind of worked because, you know, the emperor's new clothes, it sort of served us. And I think helped us to stay with it when we had some real hits, like when I say hits in the negative sense, like we tried to do a special on CBS after we left MTV and it tanked horribly and there was a scandal around it. And so it just felt like, you know, we just kept believing in ourselves.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let's move on to Bring On The Night. This is a very special song to me. So by the way, Sting, cribbed the line, "The evening spreads itself against the sky," from T.S. Eliot. Let me remind you what T.S. Eliot had to say about poets. Immature poets imitate, mature poets steal, bad poets deface what they take, and good poets make it into something better, or at least something different. Do you agree with that?
I do. I fully agree with that. But I'm just disappointed to hear that he didn't write those lines, because I love that the evening spreads itself across the sky.
What a thief. Here, play the verse, JT. All right, kill it. This might be, I think, one of the most underrated Police songs out there.
I agree. I'm starting to question my own whole feeling about this whole record now, because so far I'm like 4 for 4 anyway.
Yeah, but it's like this was one that I don't even know how I stumbled upon it a while ago. And I remember becoming like obsessed with it. And it's like, wow, it's like, why wasn't this big? Like, I think this is up there with any of their hits.
Yeah.
It's a great song. I think the real fans though know this is way better than Every Breath You Take. I mean, if you were going to play the Police for somebody that's never heard of them, I would put this on, because it kind of merges everything. It's, you know, maybe not so much the punk aspect, but definitely the reggae. And you can also see where Sting was probably going to go from this song.
Yeah, well, it definitely sounds like Sting solo a lot. That sort of soaring vocals over the thing and the Caribbean influence and all that.
If I'm not mistaken, Morty, if you want to, didn't he do like put out like a DVD and name it Bring on the Night?
Yeah, Bring on the Night was his first, it was his live DVD that he put out after, you know, after the Police. It was sort of the first thing anybody saw Dream of the Blue Turtles live was called Bring on the Night, and it had the making of the brief Dream of the Blue Turtles, his first album.
You know, when records were the only way to listen to music, a lot of times the first side sometimes was the packed with all the good stuff, and then you flip it over and you hear all the filler. And this, I'm wondering if maybe this is going to turn out to be more like that.
All
right, so I wanted to ask you about, I know we're, you know, speaking of the dark, but with the recent losses of Tony Hendra and Annie Beats, I'm reminded of your movie A Futile and Stupid Gesture.
That's right.
About doomed National Lampoon co-founder Doug Kenny, in which Tony and Ann are supporting characters. And you mentioned The State earlier in the cast of characters, and it was an incredible roster of talent that rivals, I think, any sketch group dynasty ever. So if you had to kill one of them to ensure your lasting legacy, who would it be?
Michael Ian Black.
Yeah.
I knew that was going to happen. I told him. I said, I bet you.
You know what's
I
funny?
Just feel like he doesn't bring a lot of value to the world. And so it's fine. Just as actually, in the cosmic scheme of things.
I actually had, I was going through an existential breakthrough / crisis in the summer of 2018. I was at Just for Laughs Festival in Montreal. And in the hotel, I ran into him. I was talking to somebody else about existence. And I had like a half hour conversation with him about very like Eckhart Tolle-esque stuff. And it was funny because he was kind of in a hurry. And then he heard me talking about it. And then he jumped in. And it's like, I've never met him before. I don't know the guy. And I mean, we got pretty deep, dude.
I mean, yeah. So, and he's an incredible guy. And he actually wrote this book this year. I don't know if you read it, about manhood, which is just incredible. Like, it's a beautiful book that I feel like every man, woman, and child should read.
Oh wow.
It's he's a great he's been a, you know, as most people say, who are your big influences or your mentors in life? And truthfully, they were my friends, and that, for better or worse, is how I formed. And so, and but this book, this last one, is really quite something. It's called A Better Man.
Better Man. All right, I'll definitely check it out. Morty, is there anything you want to add?
Yeah, speaking of killing the chosen one, Sting originally wrote this song as Carrion Prince, O Ye of Little Hope, for his jazz band before this last exit. So, and he wrote it from the point of view of Pontius Pilate. And then he read Norman Mailer's book, The Executioner's Song, which, if you guys know, is about Gary Gilmore, the jailed criminal and murderer who famously fought in court for the death penalty for himself. And he was eventually executed by a firing squad in 1977. And so Sting read that and changed the point of view to that of Gary Gilmore, which is a perfect segue into the next song, should you choose to take it.
Death Wish. I want to mention it. I think it's kind of filler-esque.
Very filler-esque.
Very filler-esque. But, Morty, you pointed this out to me when we were talking. He's got the Bo Diddley world beat in full effect. Kick it with the Bo Diddley world beat, JT. Gang, 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 gang. I kill it. I'm so glad I know about the Bo Diddley sound now. It's like I can hear it anytime it's played in any song.
It's so incredible. So undeniable.
Yeah, it's a great song. But I want to spend more time on track 6, Walking on the Moon. So this is their second UK number one. And in my opinion, is the best song on the record. That's what I think. I know. JT, play a little taste. Just the, I mean, I mean, this is great. All right, Kill, because we all know the song. It's just those little clashes, the drums, that like it's just everything. The melody. It's just such a perfect song.
I'm gonna
like. Whereas Message in a Bottle is great too.
I'm gonna take a way other side to this, which I hope will make the conversation interesting. Not my favorite.
Really?
Don't hate it, but like it to me, it represents, you know, that sort of like heavily chorused light guitar line, but like is a harbinger of like later Police stuff where I feel like I don't like that. Like that sort of, there's something about it that feels mushy to me. And then I also, the sort of jaunty, it reminds me also of some of their other later songs that I just, it's not, I don't hate it, but it's just, I've always sort of been like, eh.
No, I totally get that. I mean, how big was this song when it came out? Because obviously it went to number one in the UK. Did it, Morty, do you know where it placed in America?
Well, the thing was about the Police is they didn't really break in America until the next album, Zenyatta Mandata, which has the do-do-do and Don't Stand So Close to Me.
That's right.
And then, so up until that point, even guys like us, like David and me, these songs were sort of out there, you know, on radio, like college radio, like whatever would have been the equivalent. But when Zenyatta popped,
then we all
like
went
the
back.
Smiths. Yeah, it was like the Smiths. They had two incredible records where we were like, shit, I know Roxanne. Like Eddie Murphy singing it in 48 Hours was like, it was like one of those weird things. Like, how did he pick that song and know that that would be a lasting artist that many years later? You
so
know, it was just a random.
Good. That's probably how.
Yeah. It was a random British band that had like this one. I mean, now we think of it as him singing The Police. But in the early 80s, he just picked this, you know. So when Zenyatta came out and the MTV was really featuring them, because, I mean, Sting's gorgeous. And they had, you know, these three very interesting things. People were like, oh, crap, they've got two other albums and look at all these hit songs. So, you know, that was when in America.
And to me, then
instantly.
And then Ghost in the Machine, even more so. Like, that was when it was like,
that was their unforgettable fire. That was their like boom.
Exploded beyond explosion by then. Yeah.
What's on Ghost in the Machine?
Spirits in the Material World. Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic.
Yeah, dude.
Invisible Sun.
I mean, I think everything she does is definitely in their top two or three for me of all times. And then Spirits of the Material World is also one of my very favorites. And I'm always just, you know, that's the one you could listen to over and over and just like, what?
Can you find the one every time? Do you have any trouble finding the one at the beginning?
It's not easy.
Yeah.
All right. So a little interesting fact about this. Sting wrote this in Munich after a night drinking schnapps with German experimental composer. I'm going to fuck this name up. Eberhard. Say it, Morty.
Schoner.
Oh, thanks, man. With whom the band played. The riff came to him back at his hotel, so he put the words walking round the room to it. When he woke up, he wrote it down and changed the lyric. I love that. It alludes to both the airless and weightless feelings of love as well as more isolation during long stretches on the road. Do you ever have those, David? Do you ever... What's the most isolated you felt besides, you know, the COVID?
Yeah, I mean, that was the real one, right?
Yeah.
I feel like I feel different types of isolation all the time. Sometimes when you're working as a director on a movie or something, there's a certain isolation of being the only one doing what you're doing. Like, you know, everyone's looking to you for guidance and decisions all day, and then you realize that there's nobody else there who's doing that, it's this weird dichotomy of being extremely interactive and social in a way all day long with the millions of people. But then you go home and you're like, okay, I guess it's just me now having to figure this out. I don't know. There's something very interesting there. And then also this year was crazy where we did some big Zoom events this year. I was involved in a number of online events, and you have this incredible kind of celebratory, amazing experience, whether we did this state thing, we did this Wet Hot American Summer related thing. And then you turn off your computer and you're like, oh, I'm still here alone in my house. Okay.
Yeah.
Just so, I mean, I'm sure we all went through that, but yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah. It was a toughie.
Being a director, just a quickie, do you like question the motives of people trying to get more screen time and things like that, or is that already set? So that doesn't really matter. You don't.
What do you mean?
Like the isolation feeling? Is it all stemming from? I don't know.
No, I just feel like
characters.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I just feel like it's just one of those jobs where you don't usually have a partner in the job, or you don't have like somebody who's you're doing it with. You're just people are usually below you or above you, and I don't know. Yeah. Hmm.
Morty, do you want to add anything to this?
Yeah, just when they made some money with Roxanne, they bought some Roland RE-201 Space Echo units. That's the stuff that you really hear on this song that Stuart's playing off of and that Andy's playing off of. Inspired by reggae dub, you know, dub music, Stuart and Andy use these things to get those repeating delays.
Love that.
And to give it that spacey and sort of unsettling sound. You know, David might be responding to that or the chorus effect, because those are the two things that Andy used a lot.
Although that sound that he makes on everything he does is magic on the rim shot. I believe I've seen him do that live manually, even though it sounds like a echo delay box.
He did that. He actually used this live. He would trigger it with his feet. So Stuart was during this time would trigger it with his feet to give these echo things. And if you've ever seen, you can find all this footage is on YouTube. You can find like Stuart playing off himself. Because it's not the beat right before that gets repeated. It's the one before that. So there's this intricate polyrhythmic stuff. But this is why we're in the weeds.
I'd love to give out, for the people listening out there, I'd love to just give out the URL for that because I happen to know it by heart. It's www.youtube.com.
See, fantastic.
Is there like a documentary about the Police that,
yeah,
that
you two guys, of them. Does everyone stare? There's one called Does Everyone Stare that I can't remember if that's the one that Stuart did. Truth Hits Everybody, I think, is the other one, if I'm not mistaken. But Stuart did one because Stuart filmed everything.
Yeah, he was a big archivist, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He would go around with like his Super 8. So he filmed them. It's if you guys like The Police or even sort of like Sting, it's fascinating to watch them come up and everything backstage. And remember, like I said, all those places where, you know, exotic people aren't exotic to themselves. He filmed everything. So he was there for all of it. So it's really amazing to see them. Like
he's got video of Sting doing his first 8-hour tantric sex session, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And he told him to go fuck himself. And then he did.
Didn't Stuart put out a photo book too, I think, of touring and stuff, which was pretty cool.
Andy had Stuart. Yeah. Andy was a photographer.
And Stuart also has this bizarre YouTube channel, which has just some oddball random stuff on it.
Yeah.
And that's at youtube.com.
Oh, yeah. Once again, just for those, if you're writing it down, if you got a pencil, it's www.youtube.com. And you can just go on internet, whether it's Explorer or Netscape, whatever you got.
Google Chrome, whatever you want to use. All right. I want to talk about On Any Other Day, because I don't know how I feel about this one.
Oh.
Wait, more. Why are you getting
the other ones are complete bullshit.
So Stuart sings his first one on here and his only solo vocal on a Police record. It's about a crummy day of crumbling domestic bliss in suburbia with the same kind of humor he brought to his other songs. Just JT, play the part. All right, this kill it for time. So this is cheese, man. This is straight up cheese. And this is when I hear about how popular the Police were, I hear something like this. And it makes me wonder, did everyone hear this song?
You know, I think especially at that time in rock and roll, you know, you had these albums coming out and there's often like one of these goof off songs on the record just to fill it up. And this was a classic to me, like, yeah, let the drummer do whatever the fuck, you know, and it's trash.
So let me ask you this. Is this kind of like Octopus's Garden for Ringo? It's just like, you know, you know, because Ringo always dropped these cheesy songs where
they wrote
like,
those,
you know,
for him.
I'd like to be, and which I don't hate, but you know, on Abbey Road,
I think Morty points out the right thing. Like those were Beatles written songs for Ringo to do because they were sort of in that persona for him. But this is really like Stuart wants to make this dumb thing and just go ahead, whatever, you know, we'll go to lunch.
It's and just I, so
Yeah.
It's so confusing. Because, like, when you have Walking on the Moon and Message in the Bottle, and then you have this on the record, it's just very confusing.
But I think they didn't have enough. They had to, like, they definitely had to find more stuff to fill up this record. And this, and I can't imagine, I just am guessing that Sting was like, I guess, whatever. You know, it just, it doesn't quite fit in. And, like, do you remember, I mean, I loved the Jay Giles Band, and they had that album Love Stinks, and there's the song No Anchovies Please, which is basically a skit, you know, which I actually love that one. But it's, there's always just this one or two on some of these records where they're just like, let's goof around and who cares? And people still buy the record, which is true.
I'll get into a little later about Stewart's stuff, but remember, Stewart's brother is the manager. Basically, right. Stewart helps put the band together, and he's like, you know, he's the driving energy force that's the closest. Really, he's the thing that ties him to punk rock. I mean, there's like Sting's anger looking issue and all that stuff, but Stewart's energy is the thing that made them comparable to other bands they might play with at the time that were punk rock, because he brought so much unbridled energy. And so when you heard his stuff, you know, nobody knew Walking on the Moon and Message in a Bottle. Nobody knew that those would be around for 40 years. You know what I mean? Like, they were, you know, when they came out, it was like, oh yeah, that's one of the songs on the album. And this is one of the songs on the album. So it's definitely not, if you grew up with this, it's like an endearing song to you because it's so out there. And just to hear Sting singing backup on this is hysterical.
Right.
I don't hate it. Like, after hearing you guys talk about it,
don't get me wrong. I'm not
my
saying
wife
it should
made
kick
a
off
frittata and she did this thing and it's over there. It's just Cheeseball McGee.
It's like,
man.
Riffing though. It's another white boy reggae band, which I don't know if you like or not, Josh, is Sublime. It kind of reminds me of.
I hate Sublime. I never understood why people like them. All my friends in high school loved them, and I just. Yeah, man. That's
huge.
It does sort of echo, though, the lyrics to Synchronicity 2 a little bit, you know.
Absolutely.
It's a suburban Sunday morning. All that stuff.
Yeah, Stewart. Yes. Look at Sting ripping off Stewart. How's that for you?
Ooh.
But I just don't think this one ages well.
It does not. It definitely does not. All right. So I want to ask you this because this is a really interesting question. What was your best worst day? So a day that started bad but got really good.
Oh, started bad, but got really good. I like how you start by saying, "Here, this is a really interesting question that I'm going to about to say." Day that started bad and got really good. You put even extra pressure on me by saying it's a really interesting question. It makes me feel like I have to.
It's a terrible answer, but it's an incredible question.
Yeah, I mean, the question's good. The question's solid. I stand behind the question.
Yeah.
The questions are solid.
I guess I would say a day that starts bad and good maybe have been when I had a health scare or something and then found out it wasn't true, you know.
That's a good one.
Or my kid. My child had something wrong, or you know, they're like, "Oh, we had to take a test," and you find out, "Oh, it's fine." That would be, I guess, the best kind of ending to a very hard day.
That's a perfect answer. Yeah, that's a perfect answer.
Anything with kids gets me, so that beats it. Yeah.
All right. Listen, I stand behind my questions. We stand behind it. These are legit questions. Carrie killed it. Carrie was like her best worst day
was
fucking. Her stomach hurt, and then she had to go into an audition, and then she fucking nailed it.
Oh.
But there was more details and things like that around it and humor, you know what I mean?
I've definitely had, I'll tell one of the best worst.
There we go.
One time, right at one of those moments that I was talking about where I was really unsure of whether my career was, what was going to happen, I had an opportunity to pitch myself to direct a big movie, which I, you know, would have been a career defining job and also really needed in every way at that time. This is many, many years ago. And so I was living in New York and I had been working with the production company to put together this whole like book about how I'm going to direct the movie. And, you know, I had spent quite a long time collecting and creating storyboards and writing an essay and music and blah, 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 blah. And I went to this, I flew myself to LA on a plane and I rented a car and I went to the studio and I'm walking up the lawn to the studio lot to the office of the executives to pitch my thing. I'm very nervous and I've been rehearsing and rehearsing and I get a call from the agent as I'm approaching saying, oh, don't, the meeting's canceled. They already gave the job to somebody else. And I was like, okay. So this became like the worst day. And yeah. Then I sat in my rental car. You know, I was a stranger in Los Angeles at the time. I'm like, I just can't believe this. But I looked at myself in the mirror and I realized at that moment, I'm not going to quit because this is what I want to do and this is what I do. And realizing that I wasn't going to quit when that happens made me realize I'm never going to quit and that it's all going to be fine. And it suddenly became like a gloriously very, very happy moment and a very liberating day for me.
Nice, nice. And then the doctor called you and said it was benign.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, oh, that's the perfect button.
If it's not benign, then B10 or B11.
I will say that you weren't the right choice for Lord of the Rings.
Right.
Yeah. I prefer role models, to be totally honest with you.
The movie was Boys in the Hood.
Yeah,
I could see that. Yeah, perfect. Dude.
I could definitely see.
We have a different direction we want to go.
All right. So then they have this cheese song on Any Other Day, and then they come back and they drop a song like The Bed's Too Big Without You. JT, play it. Best part.
Without you.
I mean, this is the Police I like. This, you have the Cheese Ball McGee, and then you go into this. And, you know, where we'd call that other song maybe a little bit of filler. Like, this one actually showcases why the band is great.
Yep.
You could hear Sting's voice with that note, which is just incredible. The fucking, would you call those arpeggiated drums? Or, I mean, I don't know the actual
They're
term
like
of how he's...
syncopated drums.
Yeah, but it's just like the hits. It's just a great, great song. And this was their fourth and final single from the album. It deals with loneliness and heartache after a failed relationship. The song's lyric.
I also
lyric,
think that this is a one of many examples of Sting's bass lines that are so cool.
Yes.
And so restrained in a certain way. You know, they come in and out the way they do, and I think like. Like a lot of musicians I love, if Sting was not Sting, he would be known as a great bass player. Like one of the great rock, innovative rock bass players. So much going on, so interesting, so not what the obvious choice is all the time. And I love that about his playing.
Well, actually, and Morty, I'm going to take this because this is like, inspired lyrically by an incident in which Sting's first girlfriend, after being heartbroken upon their breakup, committed suicide. So this is like a heavy song,
yeah,
you know, for them. And it's like you almost listen to that and you don't even realize like the what's behind it and how heavy this is. But it's great, man. Great song. Morty, is there anything you want to add?
Yeah, I mean, that the thing you're talking about, that bass line, this was another song that was originally in Last Exit, his jazz band. And so likely it didn't have that sort of reggae bass thing because there's always talk about how Stewart kind of showed Sting where to put the bass, like on Roxanne.
Yeah.
Do-do, playing in between the beats where normally, you know, a bass player would probably play on the do-doot, do-do-doot, you know. And so this, I don't know that this song would have been what we got to hear today if it had still stayed sort of in that jazz way.
Right.
But a cover of this in 1981, a lot of people who are fans of this don't even know this is a Police song because a cover of this by reggae artist Sheila Hilton became a UK top 40 hit. It went to 35 in 81. So there are still people out there that are familiar with her version of this.
What song though went to 81 and 35? I'm curious.
I believe it was Putting on the Ritz by Taco.
Thank you.
Nice. Yeah. All right. The next one, Contact. Is this filler, guys? Is it filler?
Moment. Yeah. A bit of that. I like the lyrics.
Well, here, play 21 seconds in. See, I, all right. See, I like that part we just played, but that, I mean, that's, it's all right.
I mean, it's filler, but it's still fun. I mean, like, that's the, like, there's so much to listen to and to kind of get out of it. Even it is definitely one of the lesser songs, but there's always, it's, especially when you play those little segments, you're like, oh, that's cool. That rocks, you know?
Yeah. Morty, is there anything you want to add about this
one?
You
know, it's another alienation song, you know, not having meaningful connection. This is a Stewart song, yeah. But Sting sings this one. So, you know, Sting was open to sort of interpreting his songs unless he found them objectionable, which I'll get to, when he was like, nah, I'm not doing that one. Then he would like, that's why, you know, Stewart does on any other day. But other than that, the raincoat that they talk about is either, you know, a literal raincoat, or most people have, you know, have considered it to be a condom.
But
you know,
did Stewart keep writing songs over, or did Sting kind of take over 100% at a certain point?
He always had Miss Gradenko on Synchronicity as a Stewart song.
Oh, okay.
And then Rehumanize Yourself, I believe, I think Rehumanize Yourself on Ghost in the Machine is a Stewart song. Okay. He's got his hands in the air with the other cunts. That seems like something that Stewart would write. But he would keep writing stuff, but they also knew Andy and Stewart Andy and Stewart were really smart by saying, yo, this guy's writing great songs. I'm not fighting to get my song on the record.
Yeah.
You know, a big part of being successful in anything is knowing when somebody is talented and not getting in their way just so that you can have your voice heard. 100%. So I think that's really impressive.
Yeah. All right. So, where are we at? All right. Does Everyone Stare? So this is the third and final Stewart Copeland written track on here. And it began as a piano piece he wrote in college. It captures the turmoil of being in a relationship that's uneven in power and likely doomed. Best part of the song is this. Go ahead and play it. See, this isn't filler at all. I mean,
no,
it's
I have
like,
a lot of affection for this song. Yeah.
Yeah. I do really enjoy this one. Morty, is there anything you want to add?
Yeah, this is another one of those. If you listen to the intro of the song, we didn't play it, but it starts off with Stewart singing and playing the piano. It was a demo that he did. And then right as it's fading, because it's really cool, it starts with his demo. And then as it's phased, this opera thing comes in, and it was just some radio broadcast that somehow got recorded. But if you ever listen to the way the transition happens, it's like this, it's like one of those Beatle moments where they, like on I Am the Walrus, it just comes in and you go, oh my god.
Yeah,
like the one of the craziest happy accidents. Once again, Synchronicity.
Nice.
Yes.
Oh, that's so heavy.
That was Synchronicity too.
Ooh. All right. I want to talk about the final song on the record because this is just like, JT, play the last 30 seconds because Stewart just goes the fuck off, dude.
Come on.
Listen to that last. Turn it up.
They're ending the record with the kind of energy that most bands would start with.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great song, a great way to end the record. Phenomenal.
I'm changing my whole tone about the whole record. I think there's very little filler now that I think about it.
This usually happens on this podcast. People will come in with one idea, and then we start going through track by track, and you're like,
this podcast is
good.
Transformative.
Ooh, very transformative.
Thank you.
Morty, anything to add?
Yeah, the last thing about this is, once again, needing more material. This was actually originally recorded for Atlantis d'Amour during those sessions. A version of this was the B-side of So Lonely the year before, but they re-recorded it for this because once again, they needed more material. So this has, I mean, those playouts, like that's, if you're a fan of this band amongst like fans, you turn it up all the way to hear like his last two fills.
Yeah. Cause
they are like, it's like Elvis Costello on Blood and Chocolate. It's one of those things where if you just crank it, you can hear those last, I'm just like, what did he play after that? It's all I want to know. Like,
you know what? Short. It's like this, the one thing that listening to these three Police records has done for me is really make me realize how incredible Stewart is. Like, yeah. I always just thought he was this dude that just held the drumsticks, kind of like, you know, Max Weinberg, you know, but he's really this incredible drummer. I mean, I think he might be the most important person in this band. You know what? Fuck Sting. It's about Stewart.
Fuck that motherfucker.
Yeah. Fuck him.
You know, the way he holds the drumsticks and Max Weinberg is called the standard grip.
Oh, wow.
Because it is the standard way to hold the drum.
Jazz.
Yeah, but then. it's kind of cheesy. You know what I mean? I like the Tommy Lee finger.
For rock and roll who play with a matched grip, and you're just like, it seems like more intuitive, but it really is the proper way most people would say to play the drums is with that weird other hand thing going.
Yeah, but did he ever play the drums upside down wearing a leather jock strap like Tommy Lee?
No. And that's a very, very good point.
Yes, thank you. All right, let's do some facts and then we'll get out of here, okay? All right, so this album did so well that in early 1980, the record company reissued the 1978 single So Lonely, I love that song, that originally flopped and it went to number 6 on the UK chart.
Can I just interrupt and say, it would have sounded the same if the song was called Soul Only.
You're 100% right.
Thank you. It was important for me to
Soul only.
Soul only. Anyway, that was important, but now you can continue.
Well, I want to ask you this, because it's fair to make a similar comparison to how long it took Wet Hot American Summer to become a cult film.
Yes.
And, you know, like, and spawn a successful franchise. I mean, did you have any idea? Like, because it was like, I remember Wet Hot American Summer came out in what year? It was like 2001.
And,
2001, and it's, I feel like, I remember being in my college dorm and somebody showing me that and being completely blown away, and then you didn't get to do it again until 2014,
15, in there, yeah.
So can you give me a little, like, backstory of how that suddenly grew from that into that?
I mean, it was, you know, it started with us not getting anybody to be able, we couldn't finance it for years, and we believed in this script we wrote, and took 3 long years to find 2 cents to shoot it. And even then we thought, who did we fool? How did we get this going? And then we made this movie and didn't sell it. We took it to Sundance and nobody bought it. And it was just, it seemed like we'd be lucky if it came out on a DVD or whatever at the time. And my only goal was if it got released in one theater in New York, then we knew the New York Times would review it. And that was the bar. I was just like, I want it to come out in one theater so it gets a review. And then I want it to at some point come out on DVD so that people who want to see it can see it. And it had this sort of little pitter-pat release. It made no money. It lost all the money for the investors. And then the DVD came out many months later and very slowly but surely, starting then, people started being like, oh, what is this? And passing it around and having a certain proprietary ownership over it because it was so unknown at first. And people were like, oh, look at this. Check this out. And slowly over time, I mean, the movie finally hit its profit point in 2007.
Wow.
And it's just, yeah, it's been this insane calling card for my whole career. It's just very gratefully so. It turned out to be this perfect storm of a special moment and group of people and something that worked in a certain way. And it was a joy to go back and do more of it on Netflix.
What a cast, because it's not even just like, you know, the state people, but it's like, I mean, Bradley Cooper and then
Elizabeth Banks, Paul Rudd. Molly Shannon.
So yeah. I have to ask you this. Whose idea or who wrote it in the script when they went into town for them to shoot heroin?
It really was. I mean, I'm not saying this to be diplomatic. Michael Showalter and I really sat together and wrote the whole thing together. And so yeah. I couldn't even tell you who said, like, let's do that, because we really were very much in a synced brain at that time. And many of the ideas we had just seemed obvious to us. We were like, then they got to do this. Yeah, of course. You know, and it started just from us trading our own real summer camp stories back and forth, and then just shaping them into some kind of narrative.
So when you went into town at summer camp, you shot dope.
It was inspired by the fact that when you had time, when you were a camp counselor, having time off to go into town was like the most incredible thing, because when you're at summer camp, you're eating crappy food in the dining hall, and you have a very limited life, you know, and you don't get, so just the idea of going into like an air conditioned store is like so exciting, or that to be able to like go into a town and buy a snack, you know, of whatever, you go to McDonald's and get French fries. It was like, oh my God, it's like, it really did feel that heightened thing. So that actually is what that montage is.
It's brilliant. It is. I mean, the movie was great up until that point, but when that part hit, I was like, this is the shit, dude. It's so brilliant. Man. So thank you for keeping the franchise alive, because it was really exciting to see that come out on Netflix.
By the way, I was at Sundance in 2001. I was at that Sundance.
Really?
And I heard somebody came to my room and they go, I just saw the funniest fucking movie. It's like a summer camp. Like, they described it like, you know, like
my left foot,
of like Meatballs. Yeah, yeah, exactly. But they were like, it's like Meatballs and Animal House, but update, like, you know, but like our humor now.
Yeah.
You know, and they were like, I mean, really raving about it. And then I couldn't find it because she couldn't remember the name of it.
Yeah.
And I couldn't find it. And I waited until something came on and I was like, that's what she was talking about. I was like, that's the movie. So yeah, I always wondered about people like people that look at a movie and go, is this going to be huge, or are we going to sit around and then in 5 years, this is going to be the Rocky Horror Picture Show?
Yeah.
Like, I wonder if you can, you know what I mean? If you're like,
I feel
hold
like
on.
So much of the stuff that I've done has been the latter, you know, where people don't, we did another one called They Came Together, which again, on release was a non-event in every way. But then over the last 5 years has started to, people start talking about it and becoming more and more of a classic for many people, you know?
So basically you make something, hand it to the studio and go, just wait.
Yeah, just wait, and then somebody
6 years,
will make,
baby.
But you know, somebody will make money, not me, at some point later.
He pulls the pin and he goes, "Hold on to this for 6 years."
Yeah, not really Morty. a great business model.
No, but dude, it works, dude, and that's you. If that keeps working for you, keep doing it.
Yeah,
Morty, you got to.
Yeah, here we go. So we're gonna take you back to the Stuart. Now, this is the thing about the Stuart Copeland vocal and stuff. At between 78 and 80, he had an EP and a bunch of singles out under the pseudonym Clark Kent, that's with two K's, where he wrote and played everything. And the spirit, like his delivery and the spirit on those records, because he sings and everything, sound like his songs in The Police that were done there. But he actually brought in a song called Don't Care, and Sting turned it down. Then he does his version of it, and it does well enough in England that they get on Top of the Pops with this song. But because he's pretending not to be this character as a pseudonym, it's him with The Police. He's playing like bass and singing, and then there's Sting behind him and Andy, and then whoever else is in their band, and they're all wearing masks and like makeup and stuff. So you can find that video too of them doing Don't Care. And it sounds like a Stuart punky sort of song because he played everything on it.
Is that,
but I just think it's really
cool.
Could
you find that on www.youtube.com?
Is it on the YouTube, or do we have to go to like Snopes? Do you have the URL for that?
The Snopes one I do know actually by heart. It's www.snopes.com.
Thank you.
So I want to ask you this. Is there anything in your career that you'd like to take your name off of?
There's one thing that I wrote with Ken Marino that we fought very hard to put our name on, but lost in the Writers Guild arbitration. And then we ended up glad we lost, because it was a movie that was highly derided both by the public and the critics. And so I'll tell you what it was. It was called the That's My Boy, I think.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Was that the old man? The old man?
No, like, it's Adam Sandler.
Adam Sandler and Andy Samberg. Yeah. About a kid who has an affair with his teacher. And it's it was very hated all across the board. And we had
Adam Sandler movie.
What are you talking about? I mean, it didn't suck balls. I mean, dude, the fat guy wins the marathon at the end.
I thought it was funny, and you know, a lot of what's in there is written by me and Ken Marino, but no, most people will never know that, and that's probably fine.
Okay.
Peter.
All right, Morty, you got another fact?
I do, actually. I'll skip this one.
You're good.
They took a break from recording the album to play a BBC show called Rock Goes to College that featured up-and-coming new bands doing gigs in small venues. If you can find any of those, they're incredible when you look at the roster, like Boomtown Rats, like guys like our age will go crazy.
What was it called? Bands like
that. It's called Rock Goes to College.
Cool.
It was a takeoff because they had a thing in the 50s called jazz. It's like jazz goes to the academy.
Right.
So it was sort of like a British retake of it, but it's bands doing full sets in small venues, which is incredible. And at that show, all the songs were from Outlandish No More.
Oh, I've seen that. It's so great. Yeah.
Except for one song, which they debuted that night. It's the first time they ever played Message in a Bottle live.
So cool.
Which is really cool. Before the record had come out, and possibly maybe they had just recorded it or were just about to record it.
Yeah, that's so awesome.
So they played that live for the first time?
Yeah, everything else is from the record before it, and except they go, here's a new one that we're working on right now, and it's Message in a Bottle.
All right, David?
Yeah?
What was your first time like?
First time having sex?
Yes.
I was in a tent at summer camp.
Nice.
Teepee. Under a teepee.
Wet.
No.
Wet, hot.
No. Then no. We made out in the teepee, and then we planned out having a first time, and then we went to the clearing, like under the stars, like the campfire site. And snuck out, you know, it was like, you're not allowed to do that. And we snuck out there, and we had it all like planned out for like a week and then made it happen.
Dude.
Wow.
Shit goes down at summer camp, man. Like,
yeah, for me it did.
Dude, for me too.
Where'd you go?
For me too. I went to Seneca Creek Camp in Montgomery County, Maryland.
Sure you did.
Dude, Hamburger Hill, which was like the mountain, because my camp wasn't a sleepaway camp. It was 2 weeks, and on the final Friday over to Saturday, we'd have a sleepover up
right
on Hamburger Hill. And man, all that sexual energy. And I mean, like, I did stuff at camp way too young.
And trying to get my son to want to go to camp. He doesn't want to. And I'm like, you're going to want to trust.
Tell him that story.
Yeah.
Tell him that story.
It's like shit goes down at camp, man. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I don't know about now, but God, I mean, first boobs I ever touched. It was just to give you an idea of when it was. We were listening to Color Me Bad. I Want to Sex You Up. Noelle, if she's out there, she lives in Australia now.
How many boobs?
She had four.
Whoa.
Four boobs. It was
she
great.
She is Australian.
It was great. I actually linked up with her not too long ago. Not like we called each other or FaceTimed each other.
Like LinkedIn.
What do you have
her
URL
on LinkedIn?
For that?
She's a school teacher in Australia. It's crazy too because she's American, but now she has an Australian accent.
I have to call out before it's over Morty's T-shirt because the Pretenders actually are my favorite band. Like number
what?
One.
And Ohio.
Ohio, exactly. And that's a style of shirt that drummer Martin Chambers often wears on stage.
He does. Well, if they kept him in the band,
yeah.
I hope.
Yeah.
That's a band that I'm excited to dig into. I only know, God, what's the big song?
Brass in Pocket.
No, the...
Middle of the Road?
No, fuck, I can't.
It's going to hurt me because he probably knows what's that one, I'll Be There For You or whatever that, I'll
Stand
By.
Don't
get me
wrong. I think I just
the
I just
sad
got
dog.
No, I think I just got them mixed up with the Replacements.
Oh, well, oh, God. Another of my all-time favorites.
Is the Pretenders are, don't let me down.
Don't get me, yeah, don't get me involved.
Yeah, so
yeah,
that's,
but yeah, no.
Their first two albums, Pretender, I was thinking of this earlier, there's debuts, because the Police are one of those bands that fascinatingly love their first two albums. But it's not like the Cars' first album or the Pretenders' first album,
or the Violent Femmes,
or Weezer, where literally I go, that might be a perfect album. Neither of the Police first. In fact, I think Zenyatta Mandata is the closest they come to a hit to shit ratio, and even that's got like Behind My Camel and some stuff on it that
Right. Pretenders is like unbelievable. It is crazy. Absolutely just shattering.
Yeah. And Weezer is probably one of the last. There's only a few bands where I go, wow. Like when you listen to Weezer's Blue album, you just go,
yeah,
holy
fantastic.
Shit. It doesn't stop.
I just love that you said hit to shit ratio.
Yeah.
That is my new favorite.
One of the new quick ones.
That's dude. We're incorporating that into the show. All right. Quick questions. Then we'll get you out of here. Here we go. David, favorite song on the record?
Message in a Bottle. I know it's boring, but it's true.
Nope, I dig it. All right, least favorite song on the record?
The comedy one.
The comedy one?
Any other day. Is that what it's called?
What song on this record would you have 8-hour tantric sting sex to?
Reggatta de Blanc.
Ooh.
I would be like,
All right, now last
here
one.
Here I go.
All right, does this record deserve to be on the 500 greatest albums list, and is it ranked accordingly? What's it ranked, JT?
372.
Certainly, in my limited scope of music that I know, 100%, it would probably be in my top 50.
Okay. Should it be higher or lower?
I guess, you know, it's definitely not as a whole album, like a perfect piece of art. So I would put it in the top 100 for sure.
So then why do you think it's on the list then?
Why do I think it's on the list?
Mm-hmm.
Because
it's one of your personal favorites, but you know,
I think it's on the list because it's a truly representative album of an incredible band in the middle of their most productive and creative time, and deserves to be on for that reason. And there's, you know, to me, it's really, it also includes one of the greatest songs of all time, which is Message in a Bottle. And that's enough of a reason as well.
That's a perfect answer. David, this was so much fun, man. I appreciate you coming on.
What a
buddy.
Pleasure.
I had a blast.
How much fun.
Do you have anything you want to promote? Just go ahead.
Not really. But everything about me is at davidwain.com, W-A-I-N. And I do sort of a piano bar on Clubhouse and Twitch on Monday nights right now. And
all right.
You can just check out some of what I've been, dumb things I've been churning out during the quarantine at my website.
Okay, done. Morty, is there anything you want
to? Yeah, you'll see me on Clubhouse also. It's DJ Morty Coyle. I listen to David's. I've gone on there before, and he just goes to the piano and he goes, hold on 1 second. Here, let me just try that. And then he just goes to the piano and I'm just like, this is awesome.
Yeah, I play songs on request, even though I don't know them. And it's usually disastrous, but entertaining.
It's really entertaining. If you guys are on Club, if I can ever get Josh to go on Clubhouse or JT. DJ Morty Coyle on Twitter, B and Daddy Cartoons on Instagram, turning to Fokker Force 5 Tuesday nights on Facebook Live and listen to the guys play music. And then shout out to TJ Roche. I hope I'm pronouncing the last name right. Another Fleece Army listener who is always reposting and being so so nice to us and just liking our little things. And so,
you know, he's a Holocaust denier, right? You know that.
You know what? But I can
Holocaust
lean into
denier.
That. Just all of it, know. Or just like the outfits?
He just
because I'll tell you this,
Stripes doesn't believe it happened.
Oh, maybe okay. It, okay. Well, then
who are we to say?
Yeah, I don't know.
Thank
Were you.
You
there?
Have you been to museums?
I have one more thing I would promote if I could.
Please.
We made this TV show that I feel like was underseen called Medical Police. It's on Netflix, came out about a year ago. It's about a worldwide pandemic, but it's a comedy, action, thriller, suspense, comedy, dumb comedy show. And I love it. You should check it
out. Wasn't it a spinoff?
Spinoff of Children's Hospital?
Yeah.
Which
okay.
was the Adult Swim series we did. Yeah.
By the way, I wanted to say this, David. Like, I loved Stella so much.
Thanks.
It's such a great show, man. That was like when that was on. It was just the perfect comedy for me to watch while I got stoned on my parents' couch.
That was definitely a big example of I can't believe anyone's letting us do this.
Yeah, I mean, but it's great, dude. It's great. JT, you got anything to promote?
JT underscore podcast exec on social and at NC Podcasts for Next Chapter Podcast. We have a new podcast about trauma.
Ooh.
Let's not talk Ooh. About it.
Is that what it's called?
That's exactly it's what great. It's called. Yeah.
And Macbeth. You're still and doing Macbeth, Macbeth right?
Episode Macbeth. 3 this Friday.
Beautiful. You're hitting the deep shit, JT.
That's
you
it, are. Man.
Trauma, Macbeth,
going deep.
Holocaust.
Michael Ian Black, we're coming for you.
David, thank you again, buddy. I appreciate it.
That was fun. Thanks, guys.
Such a great show.
My pleasure.